Hello, I'm Alan Kozin, and welcome to Things We Said Today, our weekly show about all things Beatles. Beatles history, Beatles current stuff, whatever it is that comes up, we will bat it around. Joined by my regular co-hosts, Ken Michaels, who is the host of the syndicated radio show Every Little Thing, Al Sussman, a longtime contributor and now executive editor of Beatle Fan Magazine, and Steve Marinucci is absent at the moment with computer problems. He has a technician standing at his side, and he may pop in anytime. We hope he will. And in case he does, he, of course, to introduce him, is writes the Beatles Examiner column for Examiner.com and many other Examiner columns to do with various aspects of pop culture. So this week, we're going to start with something we've had to do a little too much lately, and that is to recognize the passing of someone in the Beatles world, which is, in this case, of course, Cilla Black, British singer and, I guess, TV personality. She was known more as a TV personality there than here, but in fact, we're going to talk a bit about how well she was known here. I think of her as a, you know, maybe not essential part of the Beatles world as such, but certainly part of the Beatles universe, you know, having been the hat check girl at the, or the cloakroom attendant at the Cavern when the Beatles were playing there and being taken on by Brian Epstein as one of his stable of artists, changed her name from Priscilla White to Cilla Black, and then recorded with George Martin as her producer. So she was very much really in that sort of milieu that that we spend lots of time looking at. Ken, do you have any thoughts about Cilla's passing or Cilla's career?
Well, I actually consider her a very big part of the history of the Beatles, because for people who study the songs the Beatles gave away to other artists, she's one of the top three of artists who really benefited from the Beatles association. Mm-hmm. She had three songs in particular, Lennon McCartney songs, mainly written by Paul, that were given to her. And the first single, in fact, was Love of the Loved, which didn't really do that well. And she also had It's For You, which was a top 10 hit in the UK. And then later, a song called Step Inside Love, which was also a top 10 single for her in the UK, which was used for the theme for her TV show, which ran for, I believe, 8 years in the UK.
Gentlemen.
Ah, he's here.
I'm here. Sorry
all
about
right.
that.
Well, welcome back.
Yeah, we had a technician show up. We'd been waiting all day for, and he decided to show up at the worst possible time. But in any event, it's done, and he's gone, so I'm here. And you were talking about Cilla Black?
Yes, we were.
Right. Boy, that was I have not seen the actual – somebody was saying it was a heart attack. And you probably saw the – I dug up some statements last night. Julian made one.
I have a quote from Billy J. Kramer. Mm-hmm. He put something on his Facebook page. So
Frida Kelly did too. I haven't seen her yet, but Kathy McCabe told me this afternoon that Frida did, and I'm gonna look that up as I'm sitting here, so we can have that too.
So what did Billy J. Kramer say?
I can read his quotes. I'll get it right in front of me. He said, "I am very saddened to hear about the passing of my old friend Cilla Black. I have many fond memories of Cilla and working with her. She was a very nice, fun person and exemplified all the good things in a fine Liverpudlian girl. On several occasions after shows, she would stop by my house on her way home for tea and biscuits. She was such a fun person to be around. I clearly remember when I took her to my mother's home after a show in Manchester, I played her a demo of Little Children. At that time, both Brian and George Martin were very much against me doing that song, but I very much wanted to do the song, and Cilla was very supportive and encouraging. She will be missed."
A lot of people felt that way about her. You know, that's the way she's often described. She seems to have been a very nice person. I mean, you know, I've seen some documentaries about her over the years, and yeah. Did we have other quotes?
The statement from Frida. The statement from Frida isn't up yet.
There were other quotes from Paul and from Ringo.
Mm-hmm. Chad and Jeremy also put up a quote about that, about how much they we're saddened by her passing also. Go ahead, Ken.
The one from Paul reads, "Such a shock to hear about Cilla's passing. She was a lovely girl who infected everyone with her great spirit. From first meeting her as a cloakroom girl at the Cavern in Liverpool to seeing her many times since, she always had a fun-loving dignity that made her a great pleasure to be around. She had a fine, distinctive voice and was always a bit of a laugh. It was a privilege to know her and to love her." Ringo also made a you want to read it?
Yeah, I'll read the Ringo. I have another one, too. I just heard the news. Ringo said, "I just heard the news. Cilla Black has left us. She was a good friend. We will all miss her. Peace to Cilla. Peace and love to the family. R&B XXX. And did you already read the Julian quote?
Nope.
No, I haven't seen that one yet.
Okay, Julian said, "Devastated to wake up to the news that Cilla has passed. I knew her well with Mum through the years. She was always fun, smart, and very witty. We danced a few nights away over the years on Caribbean holidays all together. I just hope they're up there now partying away and catching up on the good old times. And the tears roll in between," in quotes, he said. "You will be missed, RIP. And then finally from Giles Martin. Giles said, "It's so sad to hear about the death of Cilla. On behalf of my dad and the rest of my family," in parentheses, he said, "she was my sister's godmom. We will all miss her, and we hope that she's looking down at us all drinking champagne with her beloved Bobby."
Right. Her husband died in, what, 1999, I think, and he was her manager.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, we were talking a bit before we went on about Cilla's relative fame in different parts of the world. And, you know, for us, since we spend a lot of time looking into the Beatles world, we think of her as being relatively famous. But as Al pointed out, I think the New York Times has not yet had an obituary, and apart from running an AP wire copy thing. And, you know, I wonder if in the U.S. for people who, you know, just regular listeners, I mean, I guess she didn't have quite as many hits, certainly didn't have the TV presence that she had in Britain.
Yeah. For, I think, particularly the more casual Beatle fan, especially the younger Beatle fans, I have a feeling that a lot of them probably have no idea who Cilla Black was. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, she really did not have much of a profile here in America. She certainly was not able to promote the you know, the Lennon McCartney songs that she did record on tour in America the way Peter and Gordon did, because she didn't like to travel. And and so she really never toured here. She did appear on the Ed Sullivan Show, the same show in which the Beatles made their last live appearance in 1965. But that's a year and a half after, you know, after the British invasion began. So it was, you know, well after, you know, she had even her one minor hit here. But in England, for instance, I mean, every, as Steve knows, every media outlet had coverage of Cilla's passing within minutes after the news broke. In fact, Steve had an interesting note. And again, this is something that we would be totally ignorant of here, that there was some controversy because of the fact that at one point or another, Cilla had aligned herself or had a friendship with Margaret Thatcher, which, you know, here would be roughly the equivalent of being an acolyte of Ronald Reagan. And so there were, Steve, I think, you know, you can probably fill in the blanks on that. There were a couple of comments in.
Well, my friend Donna Jackson, who,
yes,
lives in Liverpool and sends me a lot of information about what's going on over there, told me that that was a big sticking point for them. And I have to admit, until you just said the Ronald Reagan thing, that it was hard for me to understand exactly what the problem was, because she didn't explain that, but that would make perfect sense.
Yeah.
That it was a political thing, that is kind of weird. But I mean, there's no question that she was huge over there, and she did all those shows. I mean, and we're talking about a wide swath of. She did quiz shows, you know, game shows. She did variety shows. She didn't have a top 100 song here in the States. I'm looking at the Billboard listings in front of me, and none of those singles, including It's For You.
Well, no, You're My World did scrape into the top 30.
No, I said top 100, but oh, I'm sorry, you're right. You're right. I had my glasses off. Yeah, you're right. You're My World. That's what happens when I take my glasses off. Never do that. You're My World did go in the top 30. That it hit number 26, not even the top 25, you know.
Yeah.
And It's For You it's amazing because in 64 the Beatles were so hot and It's For You didn't even break the top 50.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's crazy. They did, and I actually found this through, for those of you that have Amazon Prime Music, it's there. They remixed my brain.
Step Inside Love.
There we go.
Oh, yeah.
Step Inside Love, and made a bunch of mixes out of it. And I actually posted one on Facebook last night that was kind of a disco mix. And I actually was listening to them while I was working out yesterday. And actually, they're not bad. But it's kind of funny that they actually did that with those, you know, in 2002. But there are several. I mean, the one thing that Cilla did do is issue compilation after compilation after compilation over the past few years. There's a bundle of them out there.
Uh-huh.
The one that probably is the one that there's two that probably would be of most interest to Beatle fans. The one is Cilla the Abbey Road Decade that has all her singles. Even bigger, though, is Completely Cilla, which has all her work with George Martin. And that's six discs, including a Region Zero DVD. And the Abbey Road Decade was the first place where they issued the alternate take of Step Inside Love, which also had an alternate or an Italian version. The one version, though, that really kind of got everybody's attention, and somebody posted on Facebook yesterday, is the one with Paul McCartney on it on acoustic guitar. Humming with her.
That's I think there's video of that too, isn't there?
No, not. I think the video. If there is, I didn't see it. I didn't because I have the CD. But yeah, I think those are probably just made up. You know,
they could be silent footage with the record dubbed onto it or something.
Possibly.
Like
I don't think those are official videos. But there are pictures. There is a picture of McCartney playing acoustic guitar with her in the studio that's in the CD, and it's also on the video. So,
and there's actually there is a bootleg that exists with a lot of takes of Step Inside
Love
of them working on it.
That's right. Yeah,
with Paul there on the session. Yeah,
I believe that the bootleg though is really pretty boring. I mean, it's not. He doesn't figure very much into the. He figures more into that alternate take on the guitar than he does in the session, as I recall. I haven't heard that bootleg in a long, long time, but I'm familiar with it. But yeah, but I mean, the thing about Cilla that was really kind of, I guess, noteworthy was she started out as a pop singer, as in, you know, 60s pop, and she moved on to ballads, and I mean ballads in a big, big way. And in fact, there was one story I saw yesterday where she really ticked off Dionne Warwick for doing it because she did Anyone Who Has a Heart.
Right.
And because she also, it made her it was a big hit. So, and also, I guess, Burt Bacharach liked her work too, because he supervised the recording of Alfie that she did.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, there's a whole lot of things you can say, you know.
Yeah. Brian Epstein kind of groomed her to be more than just simply, you know, another pop singer, you know, and a pop or rock singer. You know, he really groomed her to be a, you know, an all-round entertainer, you know, which was obviously not the case with any of his other acts. And in fact, you made mention of this yesterday, that one of the last acts he accomplished before his death was the securing of Cilla's first TV series, which Step Inside Love was the theme for.
Right.
And, you know, and And from there, she went on to a couple of other variety series. And then that long, long run of, quiz shows and chat shows where she had very long runs as the host.
Yeah. It's funny to think of her as a quiz show host. That almost wants to make you, something to make you grit your teeth.
Well, apparently it's even it. I never saw Blind Date, but apparently it was very similar to, and I'm forgetting the name now, the show that Chuck Woolery hosted in America.
Love Connection.
Love Connection, exactly. Same type of thing. So she wasn't really that kind of, unctuous, game show host. It was more of a conversational thing that she would have.
When I was looking around yesterday on Amazon UK, there's DVDs of her shows. If you have a region-free player, that'll do that.
Uh-huh.
If you're interested, you could pick some of those up. I'm not sure that, obviously the ones to get would be the music ones, the variety show ones.
Right.
That Ringo was on.
Yeah, I was going to say they did a duet.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was. I didn't really write. I had all that information. There was just so much to write about her. It's really kind of amazing,
And the Beatle connections are far greater than most people realize.
Right. Yeah.
Because I had forgotten that originally George Harrison wrote The Light That Has Lighted the World for her, as well as the song that became I'll Still Love You, which Ringo recorded when it was called When Every Song Is Sung. And then I also happened to look, and I must admit, this is Wikipedia we're talking about, so I don't know if it's completely accurate. But it actually said there, and maybe you guys might know more about this, but it says that Photograph was originally written with her in mind. And then Ringo decided to record it himself. I never heard that before.
Neither have I.
But if you guys know, or maybe any of our listeners know, they can write to us about it.
That would have been interesting.
And yet here in America, she never appeared on any of the big variety shows or even the rock shows of the mid 60s, like Shindig or Hullabaloo, even though Brian hosted a segment on Hullabaloo during this first couple of months. But she never appeared on any of those shows. Again, she did make that one appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show, and I think that's the only kind of variety show appearance she ever made in America.
Are we sure she never did the Brian Epstein segments, because those were done in England?
Yeah, but those were, but the there were so few of them that actually aired. There were only four or five of them, and it's easy to find out who was on each one. In fact, I think they're probably all on YouTube, but also you can go to TV.com and find out. I know she wasn't on any of those.
Hmm. Wow.
It's interesting something you just said there, Al, about how Brian tried to mold her into being more than just a pop singer. And I know that I've talked about the song It's For You here on the show, but to me, that particular song is very, very theatrical to me. It's kind of very, it fits the Broadway
very
style.
Nice stuff.
And to me, it sort of has Paul all over it. That's got, like, I can hear him writing that more so than John. Yeah. And Step Inside Love is very jazzy.
Yeah, right.
Listen to the way the Beatles did it in the White Album sessions that's on the Beatles anthology. And that's sometimes I think when Paul works for other people or writes for other people, it gives him more of an excuse to experiment a little bit more and do something that people might think is out of character for him. So I never heard Paul talk about it. I never heard him talk about those songs. But that's kind of interesting, based on what you were saying about what Brian wanted to do with Saul.
Yeah, because Step Inside Love has kind of a bossa nova kind of feel to it, especially in that outtake. But it was definitely more of a she definitely was really kind of his project in kind of molding her into a representative of the kind of entertainment that he was really more comfortable with. Rather than the rock groups.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
I think there's, you know, one thing that obviously nothing really good comes out of someone dying. But, you know, the thing is that it often focuses with artists. It often focuses people on their work that they haven't heard in a while, or in the case of perhaps some of the listeners out there, particularly in the U.S., who never really focused on her at all. It's sort of a good opportunity to just sort of look back and see, you know, what it was. And I think, you know, maybe some of the discussion we've had will point people in the right direction. The records that Steve mentioned, for instance, and, certainly the titles. I mean, all these things can be found on YouTube, all of her hits. So definitely worth listening to. I mean, she had a really nice voice and she had a really good way of delivering a song. So
I wanted to ask all of you, if you're familiar with her work, was she, I always remember hearing it being said she was kind of like the Dionne Warwick of the UK. I don't really know if that's an accurate description, but ever since her passing, I'm looking on Facebook and people are comparing her to, say, Dusty Springfield or Petula Clark or Lulu or one of those singers. How would you describe her in comparison to those singers?
Well, the Dionne Warwick comparison is obvious because of the fact that, you know, her two of her biggest hits in England were covers, in effect, of hits that Dionne had here in the U.S., Anyone Who Had a Heart and Alfie. Mm. I guess she would probably be of the English singers you mentioned, she would probably be closer to Pet Clark than the others,
so too,
because they were both kind of very sort of pop, you know, pop-oriented. Yeah.
Yeah. Whereas Lulu and Dusty Springfield were a bit more gritty.
Yes.
Right. Right. Exactly. Dusty did get a little, kind of smooth out near the in her later years. I think you're right. I think you're right. Maybe it might be for that reason that, you know, she got somewhat ignored over here, but which is really a shame because some of those early records were really, really good too.
Yeah, that Abbey Road decade compilation is great because, in fact, there are a number of really nice covers of Lennon-McCartney songs, you know, that the Beatles themselves recorded that are on there. She did a gorgeous In My Life, you know, Yesterday, even though by the time she recorded it, everybody in the world had already recorded it. She did a very nice version of that. And even some things that, you know, you really wouldn't think of, you know, a kind of a pop middle of the road artist recording, you know, so that's definitely worth seeking out.
Right. And of course, I think you guys probably mentioned this before I came online, but she did one of the earliest Beatle covers with Love of the Loved. So,
right.
And that was one of her, that was her debut, actually.
Well, that was given to her.
Right. But she,
that was given to
she
her.
She also did a lot of other, she did Bee Gees. Mm-hmm. I mean, she covered a wide range of stuff. I'm sitting here looking at some of these titles, A Shot of Rhythm and Blues. I mean, Shotgun, the Junior Walker song. Mm. I mean, there were a lot of things that she did,
You know, a different approach to sort of getting to know her stuff if you don't know it may not be quite as in-depth. But, you know, there are a lot of compilations out there of specifically British hits of the 60s. And you hear her in the context of other people who had hits at the time. And another one that, you know, basically anyone listening to this show should probably look into anyway, if you can still get it. There was a 6-disc set called Produced by George Martin.
Yes.
50 years in recording. Yeah. And that has some of her tracks and Beatles and everything else that George Martin did. And so there too, you know, you hear her in the context of her peers and contemporaries. And it's, you know, you don't get to hear all the deep cuts, of course, you just hear a few of the hits, but it gives you some context. And that may be one way to look into it too.
The full set of that is pretty expensive because I think it's out of print, but there is a single disc compilation that is reasonable. I think it's like probably around $10 or so on Amazon. So anybody, you know, I think there's another George Martin compilation that's actually a little cheaper that was not put together by EMI, that's worth looking into also. So
it's also should be noted that she was the only female artist that Brian managed.
Exactly. Hmm. Yep.
Right.
So, and it was through John Lennon. It was John who recommended Cilla for, you know, to have a recording career and to manage her. And apparently there was an audition that she made with the Beatles backing her up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was surprised to read that, actually. That that was really interesting.
Yes.
She did George Gershwin's Summertime. Mm-hmm. And she was really nervous, and she said she was awful. And she did the song, but she didn't discuss with the band to do it in her key. And the Beatles were used to doing it in their own key, and it just didn't work out. And she didn't pass the audition the first time.
Right.
It was only later on.
Right. Did you see this?
So,
did you see the story about her doing Fever with Rory Storm? She apparently, one of her first, possibly her very first stage appearance was she did Fever with Rory Storm, and Ringo was on drums. And she requested to do Boys, which of course was Ringo's featured song, and they decided to do it as a duet. This is according to Bill Harry's Beatles Encyclopedia. They decided to do it as a duet, but Ringo would not move the mic, so she had to bend over his drum kit to sing it as a duet with him. So,
yeah, for those of you who have seen the Music of Lennon and McCartney TV special, British TV special that was done late in 65, Cilla appeared on that and lip-synced It's For You. But the funniest part is when, I guess it's Paul, introduces her and says, I'm paraphrasing, something to the effect of no show would be complete without Thingy. And... Ooh. And she and John completely crack up, and Paul is sitting there with this sort of, you know, cat ate the canary, you know, what did I do expression on his face.
Those were the days.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
Also, just based on Steve's article, well, one of his articles, he mentioned some of the other songs that Cilla covered, and she not only covered Yesterday and For No One, and you just mentioned In My Life, Al. But also Across the Universe, The Long and Winding Road. She did a couple of solo songs. She did John Lennon's Oh My Love, and she did Paul McCartney's Junk, and she also covered Bad Fingers Without You. So
there could be a tape of Cambridge 69 somewhere from.
And she also did a Randy Newman song. I've Been Wrong Before. I got to put in a plug there for Randy Newman.
Sure.
Okay. So we had some other topics we wanted to touch upon this week as well. One thing that came up a few weeks ago when we were talking about Paul McCartney's was an Esquire interview, where someone asked him if there will ever be another Beatles, and he responded. And that's an idea that has been kicked around a little bit since then, and Richard Fetter of Fort Lee, New Jersey wrote
Oh my God.
Okay, so Richard Fetter of Fort Lee, New Jersey didn't write to us and ask, but we wanted to sort of explore that a little bit more, and it's because it's an interesting question, you know, beyond the business of, you know, will there ever be another Beatles because they're the Beatles? I mean, just sociologically, it's actually sort of an interesting topic because we live in a completely different universe than the universe that prevailed when the Beatles came around. So even, I mean, from my point of view, even if there was a group that musically was as interesting as the Beatles, and I'm not sure I've heard one yet, I think that the world is such that kind of global sort of unity of focus on one group just really isn't going to happen again. But we should go around and discuss that. So let's start with Al.
Well, you know, probably the piece of ammunition that would be most supportive of Paul's case is the fact that we were talking in the 1965 show about the fact that the Beatles were absolutely that was the last year when they were absolutely universally the biggest pop act in the world. And although they were, you know, they continued to be huge superstars for the rest of their time as a group and beyond, they never were as universally beloved as they were in 1965. And the thing is that in the 50 years since then, despite how big Elton John was in the 70s, despite how big Michael Jackson was and Bruce Springsteen were in the 80s, despite how big Peter Frampton was after Frampton Comes Alive and the Bee Gees were in the Saturday Night Fever era.
And I think even after, say, Garth Brooks, you know, he was pretty big in it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely, in the 90s. There has not been one act that has even approached the kind of universal popularity and success that the Beatles had.
So that begs the question, why?
Right. I mean, from my point of view, the why is because of the fragmentation of media, and you know, obviously when we were kids and the Beatles were coming up, there were different kinds of music stations. And,
exactly.
You know, but now there are a gazillion different kinds of music stations. I mean, it's satellite and it's radio and it's internet and it's you name it, and everyone has a somewhat different focus. And I think that, you know, here's my theory. There were some pre-Beatles Beatles, specifically Frank Sinatra and Elvis Presley.
Exactly.
If you look at that period from Frank Sinatra to the Beatles, the three big acts that got the kind of mania going and, you know, and just were the biggest thing in their day – look beyond that, going backwards. You know, you have in the classical music world, like the violinist Paganini in the early 19th century was, you know, people went wild for him.
Enrico Caruso.
And Caruso, and yeah, and other opera singers too, and other instrumentalists. But they lived in an age before mass media. From Sinatra to the Beatles, you had the beginning of the age of mass media, and after the Beatles, you had the fragmentation of mass media.
And you probably have to throw Bing Crosby in there as well,
right?
Because in the 30s, and
sure.
Absolutely, and plus also another. You know, another facet of it is the fact that now families, a family unit, doesn't at 8 o'clock on a Sunday night, they don't sit down together and watch a variety show on television. They're all doing different things.
Right.
So you don't have a situation where 73 million people would watch one entertainment show.
Right.
It just doesn't happen. I mean, American Idol, when that show was at its height, they were bragging about the fact that on their, you know, the end of season show, they would get 35 million viewers, which is, you know, about half of that. And they wouldn't. And now, you know, no show would get even that because everything has become so fragmented. So it would be impossible for any act to get the kind of exposure that the Beatles got at the very beginning, and also to have the kind of mass appeal that the Beatles had.
I think there's a different way you have to look at it, Alan. I'm going to slightly disagree with you.
Mm-hmm.
I think you've got a couple of things working now that you didn't have in 64. One is social media. Mm-hmm. And we really, I don't think, have really seen the full force of social media yet. I mean, granted, you see it now. You see people like Justin Bieber getting headlines for almost everything they do.
Right, but the vast majority of at least music consumers couldn't care less about Justin Bieber. You know,
I'm just saying there are
and social media. You really overrate social media. It does not have, you know, I mean, fine, but teenagers or people in their 20s, you know, maybe, but no act would be able to, you know, there wouldn't be able to be a campaign run just via social media that would break a group on that level. There's absolutely no way.
I agree with you, but here's the way I see it. We really have not seen a group take social media in full force, really, really explode. I mean, like I said, we've seen Bieber, we've seen, you know, One Direction, you've seen those kind of things, and we just had One Direction come through town here. And
right,
there was,
but
it's more than that too. I mean, on the other side of the coin, nobody has had the social impact that the Beatles had. I think that is the difference. You need a real cultural impact, and nobody's had that yet. But it's very possible that somewhere down the road, you know, and I when we started talking about this, I'm going, no way. But it's depending on the cultural impact, something could, you know, be, maybe after we're all dead and gone, something could happen. You know, I mean, but I think the Beatles have done an incredible job of keeping their brand alive. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that really counts here. You know, nobody has the brand the Beatles have. Even Bieber doesn't.
Certainly not. I think you're discounting one aspect of social media that also works against this, which is that social media, okay, the image of the Beatles that was presented to us when they were coming up was very, very carefully guarded and manipulated to a degree.
Right.
And if the Beatles happened to egg their neighbors' houses, we wouldn't know about it. But with social media, Justin Bieber, every time he, you know, he does
farts.
Something. It's on social media. There's a very negative aspect of social media that makes it impossible for someone to be, you know, someone who maybe you might want to look up to as a great musician or something. Justin Bieber's.
I agree with that. I'm just saying there may be something, you know, that happens down the line that we can't see or we can't predict,
right?
That may throw all that into, you know,
except that the whole Facebook Twitter thing has already peaked. And I mean, I can tell just from, you know, the traffic of the people that I follow, you know, a lot of them just, you know, there's not as much activity now on those social media sites for people that are not teenagers or 20 somethings as there was a year or 2 years ago. So that, you know, all of that is, and a lot of those young people have moved on to Instagram or whatever the social media du jour of the moment is going to be. So you really overrate the impact that social media has. It really, you know, and there's no way that social media could create something like the Beatles.
I don't think you can say that. Absolutely. I agree that I can't foresee anything right now, but I don't think, but that's not to say something's not going to happen in the future. Because there's so much out there, so many, you know, the whole network of the entertainment business, it's really hard to say what's going to happen down the line.
The thing is that there are so many different kinds of music that are out there now. There's no act that would be able to cross over into all of those little genres and have the kind of mass appeal that the Beatles had. There's absolutely no way. And then they certainly wouldn't get the exposure on, you know, terrestrial radio or internet radio or satellite radio or whatever, that the kind of, again, crossover, you know, over the top coverage that the Beatles got when they finally broke here.
That's true, but we don't know what kind of media will be coming down the pike either. there could be something else coming down the pike that we don't even...
Except that everything has been splintered so much that, you know, again, 73 million people, which was, you know, nearly half of the population of the country in February of 64, at least of the population of the country that had televisions in February of 64, watched the Beatles live on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Yeah.
You know, the biggest, the highest rated shows now don't have a fraction of that kind of viewership.
Could I chime in?
Go ahead, Ken. I'm sorry.
I was wondering where you were.
No, I mean, I'm really just, I'm enjoying this so much because this sounds like a typical conversation I have with radio friends. But to me, there's two separate issues you have to look into here. There's record sales and there's impact. Mm. And when it comes to record sales, I think that it's very, I don't want to say easy, but I think it's very likely that you're going to have acts that surpass the sales of the Beatles.
Not anymore.
Mainly because of, I think so, because of the fact that it's so easy to buy music now. You don't need to go to a record store. You can just download music, you know, on your desktop or on your iPhone or your mobile device. It's so much more accessible.
Yes, but it's and, even easier to steal it, and people aren't buying it, and that's the problem. You know, that's another reason I think that it's not going to happen, because, you know, the Beatles, for all of the sociological impact and the, you know, atmospheric fun that that era was, were fundamentally a music group. And what made them so big was that they were breaking sales records all the time. Nobody is actually selling records now.
Right. And not only that, but also you've got this whole new phenomenon of streaming sites. Where even whether you pay for a subscription or not, you can go on to Spotify or Pandora, you know, or Rhapsody or, you know, whatever, and just listen to, you know, a new album that you want to hear. And, you know, they and totally legally.
Younger listeners now don't have that sense of I have to have that in my collection the way we did.
Right.
You know, and so basically the only people making money are people in music. I mean, it used to be that you were like our age or the Beatles age, and you'd learn an instrument and you'd learn to write songs and you'd perfect all that so that you could make a record and sell a record and make your living selling records. And you would go on tour to promote the record, and people would see you. And then they, if they hadn't already bought the record, they'd buy it. Now you're going on tour with no hope of selling the record. You're putting out some record so that people hear you on Spotify and maybe come to the concert. Yeah. And for most people, you know, if you're not the Rolling Stones charging $900 a ticket, which is also something very different from the Beatles days, basically, you're not even really making money from ticket sales. You're making money from T-shirt sales.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the merch. So basically what it is now is you have trained yourself as a musician to write a song, make a record, to get people to buy a concert ticket so that they will buy a T-shirt.
A T-shirt.
It's all about the schmata. Mm. We are now in the rag trade.
This is the new word for you to learn, folks. Schmata.
Schmata, schmata.
With each program, we're going to introduce to you a new word.
Right.
Education.
But
education.
I agree with so much of what all of you are saying, but at the same time, I'm always reading about how music sales are healthy. Mm. So, you know, whether it's disingenuous or not, I also think that there's the issue of impact. And I do agree somewhat with what Steve was saying, only in the sense that we have no idea what the internet is capable of doing. We're still in its infancy stages. I mean, we really have no, I was just thinking, and this is something that, you know, I've actually had this on my mind for quite a while. Why can't there ever be, back in the 80s, MTV was the biggest thing. It was the way to promote music. The video became the art form, and some people hated that for that reason, because the music should matter more than the video. But that was the primary way that, that new artists got exposure, and even veteran artists got exposure too on MTV. There could be some kind of channel that could be on the internet worldwide that could have some kind of impact maybe be the MTV of today, although there's always the language barrier problem. But if you had something like that where a lot of young people are tuned in, and again, we're not talking about local or just the United States. We're talking about worldwide. If you had some new artist that was really promoted around the world and more people could see it on the internet with their little iPhone or smartphone or whatever, you know, they could end up being bigger in popularity than what the Beatles were. Now, you might disagree with this, and I'm not saying the band would be better. I'm just saying that the exposure is the most important thing.
But
you know, without exposure, we wouldn't even be talking about the Beatles.
Got that kind of exposure because all you have to do is go onto YouTube, go onto Spotify, you know, and you know, you go onto Spotify and hear an act, you know, you might be curious about a certain act and you can listen to as many songs by them if you want. That's also true.
But I'm also thinking, I'm not just thinking about videos. I'm thinking of whatever new way to present new artists. You know, MTV wasn't just playing videos. It was also interviewing artists of the time and learning about them. You know, if there is some kind of new vehicle, and I don't even know what that might be, but I'm just saying the mere fact that the internet is worldwide gives it so much more power than even MTV United States. You know, if there was something like that where young people could unite, and that's the key word here. That's the one thing that's missing in this whole thing. You were talking about, and I've said this a million times, the Ed Sullivan Show, 73 million people. 73 million people watching at the same time. Where are you going to get that today? You won't even get that. The closest is maybe the Super Bowl or something like that. But in order to break a new artist, you got to have a large audience and people have to care. And also we're living at a time when live programming doesn't matter as much as it once did. And that also plays a big part. It's something that I really don't like about, you know, the media today. More people are so used to the fact that they'll just DVR something or they'll listen to an archive program, a radio program later on than catching it as it's happening. The whole idea of doing something live has been lost, you know, and I really miss that. So, you know, you need something like that for people in the world to be united. And if things continue as they have, and it's very possible that it will, that everything is so splintered and so specialized, and every radio station, whether it's a terrestrial radio station or satellite radio or HD radio or internet radio, is so splintered, and you've got smaller and smaller pockets out there listening to different channels, you're not going to have that kind of unity. You know, for a new artist that's out there, it's tougher to do it that way. So I think that's, like you guys have said, you know, that's part of the reason why it's so hard to have that thing called impact. You need millions of people at the same time being impacted, being affected by something. Mm-hmm. And you just don't have that. You can have record sales, but impact is a completely different idea altogether. And I think it's really sad in a way that we don't have something like the Ed Sullivan Show, or, you know, in those days you only had the three major networks and a few local channels. So you had less of a selection. And you had bigger audiences. Same thing with radio, same thing with television and cable vision. And there's so many channels, like you said, Alan, a gazillion of them, you know, you've got smaller and smaller audiences, and that's part of the problem. And it's funny that you mentioned Garth Brooks, because every time I have this conversation with people, I always bring up Garth Brooks because I remember him making a statement saying that he was the biggest in sales next to the Beatles. But think about it. How many people outside of those that listen to country music know Garth Brooks's music?
Exactly.
Do you know whose star, Hollywood star, is closest to the front door at Capitol Records in Los Angeles? It's none of the Beatles. It's Garth Brooks. Garth Brooks is right at the door.
Yeah.
Okay, but I'm just making a statement about impact and whether or not Al was talking about the cross appeal, the mass appeal of the Beatles on so many levels. With Garth Brooks, it's specialized. It's country music. If you follow country music, there's a good chance you know his songs and you may have bought many of his records. Mm-hmm. But outside of that genre, a lot of people, most people, don't really know his music. I'm not putting him down. I'm just saying that's the perfect example right there of an artist who sold a ton of records, but it's so specialized that people outside of his genre don't really know his music.
Exactly.
Well.
I'll
put him down because I'm somewhat of a fan of country, and I don't have a single Garth Brooks record in my collection. I do not like him. For one, I do resent the fact that he has the closest spot to the Capitol Records entrance rather than the Beatles. But I mean, he's what I would call more showbiz country than traditional country. I mean, I'm one of those people that, like, you know, I love Hank Williams, you know, George Jones. That I'm a traditionalist, very much so. So, but yeah, I mean, I know I'm not going to deny he hasn't had a lot of impact. In fact, if you recall, I think it was about 10 years ago or so, he was trying to stop used records from being sold. So, I mean, he's basically Mr. Money as far as that situation goes. I mean, that's his.
And even as big as Garth was in the 90s, you know, especially once he kind of took himself off the road, you know, now he can barely get arrested on country radio. And then country radio is the biggest, you know, not so much in New York, but the rest of the country. I think there are still more country stations than any other format, any other pop music format. And Garth Brooks couldn't get arrested on country radio now, as big, as huge as he was. So that's why, again, you know, I just don't think there's any, and he, you know, really did not cross over that much into other genres.
No, he did not.
He did. And, you know, so that, again, you know, kind of makes the point that there's just it's nearly impossible for an act to have that kind of absolute all-consuming crossover appeal. And
when you think about it, the biggest selling artists have had crossover appeal.
Sure.
I mean, Michael Jackson is one of those people. Those are the ones that and they were looking for that. They were looking, like when Michael Jackson tried to get Beat It on album rock stations to give him credibility. You know, he got played there. He got played on pop radio, top 40 radio, R&B radio. Same thing with the Beatles. I mean, with the Beatles, after they broke up, they got played on what became progressive rock and classic rock stations. They got played on adult contemporary stations. They got played on adult standard stations. They're played on Muzak stations. They're played kind of everywhere. In that regard, you're not going to find that with most artists. I mean, the ones that you will are the rare exceptions.
Yeah. And you also had a lot of people across different genres recording Beatles songs, including Arthur Fiedler and the Boston Pops.
Exactly.
You know, so everybody was, you know, that's another big thing. I mean, you really haven't seen, you've seen some people, for example, recording Michael Jackson, but not you haven't seen, say, Tony Bennett trying to sing Michael Jackson. So, you know, it's that kind of situation, too. You know, I mean, if the songs are adaptable and everybody can do them, you know, they get get covered. If not, they don't, you know, so.
That's very true. And in some ways, as much as I never liked American Idol, you know, when you have a show that's devoted to the Beatles and young kids singing Beatles songs, that's reaching, you know, a young audience of people who like that show.
Mm-hmm.
And so the mere fact that the Beatles music, like you said, is covered by so many different types of artists, it's hard to find any, you know, real legendary singer out there who hasn't covered a Beatles song somewhere along the line or a solo Beatles song. So, you know, that's really important. And that keeps the music alive beyond the Beatles' own recordings.
Right. But on the other hand, American Idol really didn't. The American Idol Beatles stuff didn't really have the impact that a lot of people were saying.
Oh no, I've always said that the only way to make Beatles music sound boring is to put it in the hands of the contestants on American Idol.
Mm-hmm.
Because of
Glee.
Because
or Glee.
Of, of the well, I don't, you know, Glee, and I never saw enough to make a judgment, but certainly in the case of American Idol, where they, you know, where they mandate a particular form of milquetoasty, you know, blah musical presentation. Those Beatles tribute shows were
oh,
like,
yeah. Oh,
torture.
God.
Absolute torture.
Yes. Yeah.
But even still, it's introducing the name Beatles to a lot of young people who might not otherwise be even thinking about them.
And again, you know, when you mention sales and things like that, again, you know, what's the biggest selling album of this century so far?
One.
Absolutely.
You never know from decade to decade if there's going to be some Beatles release that will end up being huge. So kind of like in the 90s, we had the Beatles anthology, and we had three double CDs there that did very well. Not to mention the when it was video cassettes, and then later the DVD. That was huge. Live at the BBC did really well, too. And then in the last decade, you had one. So who's to say there won't be something coming soon?
Oh, yeah.
That could do really well. You know?
Every time one has been released in some new form, whether it was, when they released for downloads on iTunes, immediately the sales would spike, and it's the only album of the first 15 years of this new century that is really competitive with it is the Adele album 21. You know, even, you know, no Jay-Z, no Taylor Swift. You know, no Eminem, you know,
that's so extraordinary. It really is. It's like the Beatles defy all logic. It's not like, you know, it only matters when the music came out. It doesn't matter whether it's 30 years ago, 40 years ago, or 50 years ago, something will come along that will sell extremely well.
They're the exception to every rule, at least musically.
Yeah. Well, and also part of it is because anytime one of the things comes out on any format, those of us who collect it have to buy every available new format. And that is why Apple should be paying our health insurance.
Right.
Because when we're gone, that's it. Party's over.
I agree.
Well, guys, this was a fascinating chat about a number of things, and it's time to go for this week. We should say how to get in touch with us. Ken, can you give the email address?
Yeah, our email address is thingswesaidtodayradioshow@gmail.com. Don't forget we also have a Facebook page for Things We Said Today. We have a Twitter page, which is what, Steve?
Things We Said Fab, so with the @ in front of it. So you can send us a note.
Okay,
so feel free to write us with questions, write us with topics you'd like us to look at. If you actually are Richard Fader from Fort Lee, New Jersey, write to us anyway. And you can get in touch with basically each of us on our Facebook pages. Mine is Alan Kozin or Alan Kozin Remixed. Steve?
Steve Marinucci, Beatles Examiner. I'm all over the place. Let me mention one quick thing before you go on. Somebody was telling me that Netflix has the movie
Living is Easy with Eyes Closed.
right. Thank you. And I have not seen it. I saw part of it, but it's there on Netflix. It kind of came in quietly. It's about John Lennon in Spain. So there's a tip for anybody. Anyway, my email address is beatlesexaminer@gmail.com.
Ken, and yours?
And my email is everylittlething@att.net. And also, please check out my website, which is kenmichaelsradio.com. Can I mention one more thing? Because there's one thing I'd really like to plug here. I do a live version of Every Little Thing, which is on a station in Connecticut, WNHU. And sometimes what I will do is send the last hour of my show, which has a theme to it, to the website Global Texan Chronicles, and then they run it for a whole week. And I've done two recent specials on Ringo, for one for his birthday, which was a two-hour show, and one on Ringo, which I call the Ringo Starr Album Sampler. And I played 18 songs in a row, one song from every studio album from Ringo in chronological order, from Sentimental Journey to Postcards from Paradise. And we've gotten a terrific response on the website. So if you want to listen to it, you can stream it anytime. It's at globaltexanchronicles.com. Two different Ringo Starr specials, which were originally on WNHU, and now it's on that website.
Okay.
So there you go.
Okay, and Mr. Sussman?
You can reach me at Al Sussman on Facebook or through Twitter at ASUS49.
Okay, and you might as well mention your book since
Or through www.paradingpress.com if you want to get a copy of Changing Times, 101 Days That Shaped the Generation, or you can pick it up next weekend when this airs, next weekend at the Chicago Fest for Beatles Fans, August 14th, 15th, and 16th at the Hyatt Regency O'Hare.
Okay, and since we are shamelessly promoting, there is my book, The Beatles, From the Cavern to the Rooftop, published by Fiden Press in 1995, still in print, and the ebook, Got That Something, How the Beatles' I Want to Hold Your Hand Changed Everything, which you can get from Amazon.com.
And can I add a plug, too?
Sure, Steve.
I just want to tell everybody about my ebook, Meet a Monkey, Davy Jones. It's very inexpensive, and it has my two interviews with Davy Jones in it.
Okay. So, for Things We Said Today, this is Alan Kozin, and we'll see you next time.